In these uncertain economic times, you've got to do whatever you can to save money. One of our biggest expenses can be our cars, especially when unexpected repair bills hit. Not anymore. If you own a vehicle with less than 130,000 miles, is less than 12 years old, has a warranty about to expire, or even no warranty at all, you could stop paying for car repairs. Roadside assistance, towing, and rental coverage are all included. Don't wait for the next repair. Make one free call right now to see if you qualify. If your vehicle is less than 12 years old, has less than 130,000 miles, even if it's out of warranty, paying for car repairs can become a thing of the past. Call us right now and get your car protected before your next repair bill hits. Get protection and no more repair bills. Call 800-696-1030. Again, 800-696-1030. That's 800-696-1030. 800-696-1030.
Joe had huge problems with the IRS.
I knew it was coming. I hadn't filed taxes since 1990.
All the IRS letters coming in added up to a nightmare.
To get up to like $68,000, my heart started beating fast. It's like, there's no way, man. I mean, I ain't going to be able to do this.
Then they stopped his paycheck.
So that's when I started making phone calls and found U.S. Tax Shield.
U.S. Tax Shield went to work immediately.
They just took the bull by the horns. What blew my mind is he called the IRS right then and there.
So why is U.S. Tax Shield A-plus rated with the Better Business Bureau? Joe knows.
They saved me a ridiculous amount of money.
If you owe more than $10,000 to the IRS or state, choose the company Joe chose, U.S. Tax Shield.
It was the best decision I made. U.S. Tax Shield is the way to go. Life is good. Thank you, Lord.
Call 800-471-3287.
U.S. Tax Shield. Boo-rah. Yes.
800-471-3287. 800-471-3287.
The internet will never be the same. You're listening to K98Talk.com.
Whoa! Good God, y'all!
What is it good for?
Absolutely!
Now get started again!
Ladies and gentlemen, he's a child of God, a husband, NRA conservative, radical right-wing supervillain, and Twitter rock star. American by birth, Texan by choice, and a badass by nature. He's the owner of TomOHalloran.com, OHalloranMedia.com, and PatriotRadio.net. Please welcome Tom O'Halloran.
There ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the U.S.
And good morning. Welcome to the Thursday edition of the Patriot Radio Show. And this is a very special edition. Again, welcome to the Patriot Radio Show. I am your host, Tom O'Halloran. On Twitter, I am Sir underscore TPO himself. And my primary blog is TomOHalloran.com. When you get there, please be sure to follow me on Twitter, Facebook, Spreaker, any other social media that you fancy. Also, please follow my editor, Veronica Coffin. Veronica manages 15 websites on our network, and without her doing that, I couldn't do this. Please find us on Facebook. It's facebook.com/Patriot Radio Show. And don't forget to like us over there. If you'd like to be a part of the conversation today, please call our studio line at 832-761-1766. I'm on air 5 days a week now. If you hadn't heard, we moved from 3 nights a week to 5 days a week at the 1st of July. Every Monday through Thursday, I do this show, the Patriot Radio Show. On Fridays, I continue my Jihad on America show. On Fridays, I do the Islamist show to cover the Islamists. I'm trying to use nice words here, folks. To cover the Islamists in America and tell you who they are, what they want, and why you should be afraid. If you did not catch my show on the Muslim Brotherhood, my show Islam is Not a Religion, or my show Islamophobia, please find your way to patriotradioshow.com. Catch all three of these shows. They will give you insight and perspective on the Islamic topic that you have not heard anywhere else. They'll also give you a solid foundation upon which we build each and every Friday as I continue to pull back the mask of Islam and share with you what's being done in the name of Allah both here and abroad. And I do the news about Islam abroad because it's a look into the future of what's in store for us here in America if we continue to allow the cancer of Islam to spread in the homeland. Keep abreast of my shows, listen to the live stream as well as the archives of any shows that you may have missed. And yes, today, folks, I am broadcasting from an underground bunker deep in Arcantana, Brascarado, and I'm here to educate, irritate, and agitate. In fact, I've got a very, very special agitation for you today. Evil from within. And I'll share it with you. We're going to take the lid off of the truth about John McCain. But before we get started, I'd like to thank my sponsors for the show. Dr. Dave Krupa, K-R-O-U-P-A. His website is drkroupa.com. Dr. Dave Krupa is a chiropractor based out of Houston. He's also a nutritional health specialist, not just advising you on smoothies and stuff. This man will find nutritional supplements to cure what ails you. He doesn't give you drugs from Big Pharma that need a whole list of disclaimers and that only mask your symptoms. He will find what ails you and cure it naturally, the way God intended. I'd also like to thank the Republic of Texas. Their website is thetexasrepublic.com. Fine group of folks fighting to regain international recognition of Texas as a sovereign, free nation. While you're on the website today, folks, listening to this show or just perusing TomOHalloran.com or the Patriot Radio Show, please take a moment to peruse the Amazon Marketplace. You know you want to buy stuff. You know you like buying it online. Please buy it at my Amazon Marketplace. You don't pay a dime more than you would going directly to Amazon, but they shave off a few pennies of each dollar and send it on this way, and it helps cover the cost of keeping the servers live, keeping the equipment updated, and so forth and so on. Also, try to click the button, the RT Legal Fund. That's the Republic of Texas Legal Fund. My friends, Doc Krupa and Susie Kamak, had been arrested by the Kerr County Sheriffs for a fraudulent charge of simulating a legal process. It's BS, folks. It probably will never see the inside of a courtroom, but the sheriff has a vindictive streak about him, and he is trying to hurt these individuals financially. Please click on the RT Legal Fund button. Donate what you can. We appreciate it. Okay, last week, John McCain calls Donald Trump a name, I don't know, a cuckoo bird or something like he calls any real conservative. It's a badge of honor to those of us who know John McCain. Wacko birds or something. And Donald Trump, in Donald Trump style, didn't stand for it. He said something about Donald or about John McCain, and everybody said, "Oh, you better treat him with respect. He's a war hero." Donald Trump says he's not a war hero. He just got caught. Donald Trump has done a lot for veterans. He's put a lot of money up, put his money where his mouth is. But I've got to agree with him. We've used the word hero way too liberally, way too loosely in America for my taste. To me, a hero is one who runs into a burning building to save a baby. Now, many of us joined the military. I joined the military. I served for 10 years. It doesn't make me a hero. When you join the military and you know you're going into combat, yeah, more so. But still, there's a lot of people that go into combat zones that never see combat. They're supply specialists or camp coordinators or cooks. There isn't really anything that heroic about it. It's adventuresome. Calling everybody that's ever been in the military a hero diminishes the value of the real heroes. And we have special medals for those people. The Medal of Honor, the Silver Cross, the Bronze Star. All these are medals for valor, medals for heroism, bravery. But John McCain got caught. Okay, his plane was shot down. He was on a bombing mission. His plane got shot down. He spent a few years, I think 5, maybe 7 years, in the POW camps in North Vietnam. And when he got out, he parlayed that into a political career. Oh, look at me. I'm a POW. Vote for me. And he got into office, and this is some 30 years back. He's been a senator for, geez, long, long time. Far longer than anybody should be allowed it to be a senator, that's for sure. But what we're going to look at today is, who is John McCain? What did he do in the POW camps? And what has he done since? And in the next 40 minutes, your jaw is going to drop when you hear the things that John McCain has done, not for the families of POWs, as you would expect, what he has done to the families of the POWs, the way he has sucked up to the Pentagon, the way he has rolled over and played their puppy, the way McCain has hidden the truths, hidden the facts about the POWs, those that were left behind. All fine for him. His daddy was an admiral, I believe. And when McCain got thrown into the POW camp, it wasn't long before he started crying, and he confessed to being a war criminal and bombing civilians and all this stuff. And he got special treatment for this. The other guys he got shot down with were treated much, much worse than him because he sang like a songbird. We're going to go through a column written by Sidney Shanberg. The column was posted in the American Conservative some 5 years ago. And I've known what a scumbag McCain was for a very long time. In fact, I was one that wasn't surprised back in 2008 after Obama got elected. And Glenn Beck went on his TV show when he was still on Fox, and he says, we can thank God that Obama was elected rather than McCain. And I'm like, yep. Most people that I've talked to since then that I mentioned that, they're like, what? Better off with Obama than McCain? Beck had a point. Obama was an outright socialist, an obvious communist, an American-hating SOB. He appointed communists around him, Van Jones and the like. But McCain has been a progressive from his first day in office. And as Glenn Beck says, McCain would have gotten us to the same place. It just would have been a lot slower. And it's like throwing a frog into a boiling hot pot of water. With Obama, we wake up and say, whoa! With McCain, it'd be more like putting a frog in a lukewarm bucket of water and turning the heat up under it. The change would come slowly, and we probably wouldn't notice it for a very long time, but we would end up in the same place. McCain has made a career out of lying about what happened in Vietnam, about what happened when we left, about how many people were left behind in prison camps, and the things that he said and did to the people that were trying to find the truth will shock you. People are upset because Trump says he's not a hero. When you hear what he says to the families that are coming into Senate hearing meetings trying to find out where their sons are, it will shock you that this man ever got reelected once, let alone all these years. Again, this from a column by Sidney Shanberg, written in the American Conservative back in July of 2010. I'm not fond of reading on this show. I generally take the news in, talk about it, reading a snippet here and a snippet there. But to get the full context, I will be reading much of this column over the next 40 minutes. I want you to get as much of the flavor, as much of the meat as I can get across in these few minutes. John McCain, who has ridden to the political prominence on his image as a Vietnam POW war hero, has inexplicably worked very hard to hide from the public. Stunning information about the American prisoners in Vietnam, who, unlike him, did not return home. Throughout his Senate career, McCain has quietly sponsored and pushed into federal law a set of prohibitions that keep the most revealing information about these men buried as classified documents. Thus, the war hero, who people would logically imagine as a determined crusader for the interests of POWs and their families, became instead the strange companion, the strange champion of hiding the evidence and closing the books. Almost as striking is the manner in which the mainstream press has shied from reporting the POW story and McCain's role in it, even as the Republican Party has made McCain's military service the focus of his presidential campaign. Reporters who had covered the Vietnam War turned their heads and walked in other directions. McCain doesn't talk about missing men, and the press never asks him about them. The sum of the secrets that McCain has sought to hide is not small. There exists a telling mass of official documents, radio intercepts, witness depositions, satellite photos, and rescue symbols that pilots were trained to use, electronic messages from the ground containing individual code numbers given to airmen, a rescue mission by special forces that was aborted twice by Washington, and even sworn testimony by two defense secretaries that, quote, men were left behind.
This imposing body of evidence suggests that large numbers, documents indicate probably hundreds, of U.S. prisoners were held in Vietnam, were not returned when the peace treaty was signed in January of 1973, and when Hanoi released 591 men, among them Navy combat pilot John S. McCain. The Pentagon has been withholding significant information from POW families for years. What's more, the Pentagon's POW-MIA operation had been publicly shamed by internal whistleblowers and the POW families for holding back documents as part of a policy of debunking POW intelligence, even when the information was obviously credible. The pressure from the families and Vietnam veterans finally forced the creation in late 1991 of the Senate Select Committee on POW-MIA Affairs. This next line will blow your mind. The chairman was John Kerry, the coward of the entire war. This man submitted his own name for Purple Hearts for very, very minor injuries, trying to set himself up as an injured combat veteran. The chairman was John Kerry. McCain, as a former POW, was its most pivotal member. In the end, the committee had become part of the debunking machine. One of the sharpest critics of the Pentagon performance was an insider, Air Force Lieutenant General Eugene Teague, who headed the Defense Intelligence Agency during the 70s. He openly challenged the Pentagon's position that no live prisoners existed, saying that the evidence proved otherwise. McCain was a bitter opponent of Teague, who was eventually pushed into retirement. Included in the evidence McCain and his government allies suppressed or sought to discredit is a transcript of a senior North Vietnamese general's briefing of the Hanoi Politburo, discovered in Soviet archives by an American scholar in 1993. The briefing took place only 4 months before the 1973 peace accords. The general, Tran Van Quang, told the Politburo members that Hanoi was holding 1,205 American prisoners, but would keep many of them at war's end as leverage to ensure getting war reparations from Washington. We've got a whole lot more coming up. Please stick with us. We're going to be back, and this will piss you off. It's the Patriot Radio Show, and I'm your host, Tom O'Halloran.
Girls, I know the one place where you are guaranteed to find a great guy. You know, the kind of guy that carries you off on horseback and flies you to Paris and likes to talk about his feelings. He's at the movies. Well, in the movies. Where else will you find a funny architect with airbrushed abs? Girls are lining up for guys like this, but not you, because you bought your tickets ahead on Fandango. So adios, long lines, and hello, handsome astronaut, brain surgeon, spy.
Make a date with Fandango, your ticket to the movies.
Family night at the movies is a tradition. It really bonds us together. I love you guys so much. Especially this one. I mean, of course, there's all the, his popcorn's bigger than mine, and she's hitting me. Fandango makes it all so easy with tickets in advance. Honey, you enjoy the chick flick? Kids, you enjoy the animated movie? Daddy's gonna go watch things go boom. That's how we do family movie night.
Bring your family closer together with Fandango, your ticket to the movies.
Girls, I know the one place where you are guaranteed to find a great guy. You know, the kind of guy that carries you off on horseback and flies you to Paris and likes to talk about his feelings. He's at the movies. Well, in the movies. Where else will you find a funny architect with airbrushed abs? Girls are lining up for guys like this, but not you, because you bought your tickets ahead on Fandango. So adios, long lines, and hello, handsome astronaut, brain surgeon, spy.
Make a date with Fandango, your ticket to the movies. Family night at the movies is a tradition. It really bonds us together. I love you guys so much. Especially this one. I mean, of course, there's all the, his popcorn's bigger than mine, and she's hitting me. Fandango makes it all so easy with tickets in advance. Honey, you enjoy the chick flick? Kids, you enjoy the animated movie? Daddy's gonna go watch things go boom. That's how we do family movie night. Bring your family closer together with Fandango, your ticket to the movies.
Boost Mobile believes you deserve more choice.
You can pick your phone,
pick your plan,
and
you can even pick our new spokesperson
and sell that phone.
The Samsung Galaxy S5 will walk your face off.
Give it to me through tears.
Get unlimited talk, text, and data. Starting at $40 a month.
Wow.
Pick your phone.
Pick your plan.
And pick your next spokesperson at BoostMobile.com.
Visit Boost Mobile through the RER Marketplace.
Patriots, have you ever wondered why Google, Yahoo, AT&T, Comcast, and so many others offer free email? Who offers free stuff these days? They do it so that millions will sign up with them. Then as these people send what they think are private emails, the emails get scanned and tagged according to the content of the emails. These companies then sell your email addresses to companies that are selling things that you may be interested in based upon the content of your emails. If you're a veteran or if you have a vet in your family, go to usvetmail.net. Get an email address, your name at usvetmail.net. It's not only private, but it shows pride in your veteran or your pride of service. We never scan our clients' mail, and we never, ever sell or share your information with anyone. Thank you.
I reckon the storms are brewing. Reckon so.
Reckon you got a hotel?
Reckon no. Money's tight.
Reckon Priceline Express deals can get you a great deal. Wherever you mosey.
You reckon?
We reckon.
I reckon our work here is done. Vamanos!
Express deals. Priceline savings without the bidding.
Think he's happy?
Ooh, I reckon.
Tom O'Halloran, holding the line against tyranny from Washington, D.C.
I am America, one voice, united we stand. I am America, one hope to heal our land. There is still work that must be done. I will not rest until we
And we're back. This is the Thursday edition of the Patriot Radio Show. I'm your host, Tom O'Halloran. And today we're going through a column written by Sidney Shanberg that was in the American Conservative back in July of 2010, taking the mask of hero off John McCain. Just before the break, we were talking about as Vietnam came to the war came to an end and the peace talks were ongoing, a Vietnamese general had admitted that there were 1,205 American POWs being held. After the treaty was signed, 995 were released. Or no, I'm sorry, 590 were released, which leaves
about 700 unaccounted for. Throughout the Paris negotiations, the North Vietnamese tied the prisoner issue tightly to the issue of reparations. They were adamant in refusing to deal with them separately. Finally, in a February 2nd, 1973 letter to the Hanoi's premier, Pham Dinh Van Dong Nixon pledged $3.2 billion in post-war reconstruction without any political conditions. But he also attached to the letter a codicil that said that the aid would be implemented by each party in accordance with its own constitutional provisions. That meant that Congress would have to approve the appropriation, and Nixon and Kissinger both knew that Congress was in no mood to do so. The North Vietnamese, whether or not they immediately understood the double talk in the letter, remained skeptical about the reparations promise being honored, and it never was. Hanoi thus appears to have held back prisoners, just as it had done when the French were defeated at Dien Bien Phu in 1954 and withdrew their forces from Vietnam. In that case, France paid ransom for the prisoners and brought them home. But in a private briefing in 1992, high-level CIA officials told Sidney Shanberg that as the years passed and the ransom never came, it became more and more difficult for either government to admit that it knew from the start about the unacknowledged prisoners. Those prisoners had not only become useless as bargaining chips, but also posed a risk to Hanoi's desire to be accepted into the international community. The CIA official said their intelligence indicated strongly that the remaining men, those that had not died from illness or hard labor or torture, were eventually executed. Sidney's own research, which is detailed in this paper, has convinced me that it's not likely that more than a few, if any, are alive in captivity today. The CIA briefing at Langley, Virginia headquarters was concluded off the record, but because of evidence from his own reporting that has since brought him to the same conclusion, he felt there was no longer any point in not writing about the meeting. For many reasons, including the absence of political constituency for the missing men, other than their families and some veteran groups, very few Americans are aware of the POW story and of McCain's role in keeping it out of the public view and denying the existence of abandoned POWs. That is because McCain has been hardly alone in his campaign to hide the scandal. The Arizona senator, now the Republican candidate for president, that's when this column was written, has actually been following the lead of every White House since Richard Nixon's, and thus every CIA director, every Pentagon chief, and national security advisor, not to mention Dick Cheney, who was George Bush's defense secretary. Their biggest accomplice has been an indolent press, particularly in D.C. Bitterly opposed by the Pentagon, and thus McCain, an early and critical McCain secrecy move involved a 1990 piece of legislation that started in the House of Representatives. A brief and simple document, it was called the Truth Bill, and would have compelled complete transparency about prisoners and missing men. Its core sentence reads, quote, "The head of each department or agency which holds or receives any records and information, including live sighting reports, which have been correlated or possibly correlated to the United States personnel listed as a prisoner of war or missing from action in World War II, the Korean conflict, and the Vietnam conflict, shall make available to the public all such records held or reviewed by that department or agency." Bitterly opposed by the Pentagon, and thus by McCain, the bill went nowhere. Reintroduced the following year, it again disappeared. But months later, a new measure, known as the McCain Bill, suddenly appeared. By creating a bureaucratic maze from which only a fraction of the documents could possibly emerge, only records that revealed no POW secrets. It turned the Truth Bill on its head. The McCain Bill became law in 1991 and remains so today. So crushing to transparency are its provisions that it actually spells out for the Pentagon and other agencies several rationales, scenarios, and justifications for not releasing any information at all, even about prisoners who were discovered alive in captivity. Later that year, the Senate Select Committee was created, where Kerry and McCain ultimately worked together to bury the evidence. McCain was also instrumental in amending the Missing Persons Personnel Act, which had been strengthened in 1995 by POW advocates to include criminal penalties, saying any government official who knowingly and willfully withholds from the file of a missing person any information relating to the disappearance or whereabouts and status of a missing person shall be fined as provided in Title 18 or imprisoned for not more than 1 year or both. A year later, in a closed House Senate conference on an unrelated military bill, McCain, at the behest of the Pentagon, attached a crippling amendment to the act, stripping out its only enforcement teeth, the criminal penalties, and reducing the obligations of commanders in the field to speedily searching for missing men and to report the incidents to the Pentagon. McCain argued that keeping the criminal penalties would have made it impossible for the Pentagon to find staffers willing to work on POW matters, which is an odd argument to make. Were staffers only willing to work if they were allowed to conceal POW records? By eviscerating the law, McCain gave his stamp of approval to the government policy of debunking the existence of live POWs. McCain has insisted again and again that the evidence, documents, witnesses, satellite photos, two Pentagon chiefs' sworn testimony, assorted rescue missions, ransom offers apparently scorned. McCain insists that this has all been woven together by unscrupulous deceivers to create an insidious and unpatriotic truth, or myth. He calls it the bizarre rantings of MIA hobbyists. He has regularly vilified those who keep trying to pry out classified documents as hoaxers, charlatans, conspiracy theorists, and dime store Rambos. Some of McCain's fellow captives in Hoa Lo prison in Hanoi didn't share his views about prisoners left behind. Two Pentagon chiefs' sworn testimonies. Before he died of leukemia in 1999, retired Colonel Ted Guy, a highly admired POW and one of the most dogged resistors in the camps, wrote an angry open letter to the senator in an MIA newsletter. As a response to McCain's stream of insults hurled at MIA activists, Guy wrote, "John, do these insults include Senator Bob Smith, a New Hampshire Republican and an activist on POW issues, and other concerned elected officials? Does this include the families of missing, where there is overwhelming evidence that their loved ones were last known alive? Does this include some of your fellow POWs? It's not clear whether the taped confession McCain gave to his captors and to avoid further torture has played a role in his post-war behavior in the Senate. That confession was played endlessly over the prison loudspeaker in the Hanoi prison to try to break down other prisoners, and was broadcast over Hanoi's state radio. Reportedly, he confessed to being a war criminal who bombed civilian targets. The Pentagon has a copy of the confession but won't release it. Also, no known outsider has ever seen a non-redacted copy of the briefing of McCain when he returned from captivity, which is classified but could be made available by McCain." All humans have breaking points. Many men undergoing torture give confessions. They often use telling huge lies, so their fakery will be understood by their comrades and their country. Few will fault them. But it was McCain who apparently felt he had disgraced himself and his military family. His father, John S. McCain II, was a highly regarded rear admiral, then serving as commander of all U.S. forces in the Pacific. His grandfather was also a rear admiral. In his best-selling autobiography in 1999, Faith of My Fathers, McCain said he felt bad throughout his captivity because he knew he was being treated more leniently than his fellow POWs, owing to his high-ranking father and thus his propaganda value. Yeah, that and the fact that you confessed. He says when he returned home, he told his father about the confession, but he never discussed it at length. The admiral, who died in 1981, didn't indicate he heard anything about it before, but he had. In the 1999 memoir, the senator writes, "I only learned that the tape had been broadcast outside the prison and had come to my the attention of my father." Many stories have been written about McCain's explosive temper, so volcanic that colleagues are loath to speak openly about it. One veteran congressman who had observed him over the years asked for confidentiality and made this brief comment: "This man is not at peace with himself." He was certainly far from calm on the Senate POW committee. He browbeat expert witnesses who came in with information about unreturned POWs. Expert witnesses. Family members who became personally, who have personally faced McCain and pressed him to end the secrecy and who have been treated to his legendary temper. He screamed at them, insulted them, and brought women to tears. Most of his responses to them have been versions of, "How dare you question my patriotism?" In 1996, he roughly pushed aside a group of POW family members who waited outside a hearing room to appeal to him, including a mother in a wheelchair. But even without answers to what may be hidden in the recesses of McCain's mind, one thing about the POW story is clear. If American prisoners were dishonored by being written off and left to die, that's something the American public ought to know about. And there are 10 pieces of key evidence that men were left behind. And we're going to go into that as soon as we come back. Please stick around, folks. We do have a lot more coming up. It's the Patriot Radio Show with Tom O'Halloran, taking the mask of hero off John McCain. John Yellowbelly McCain.
Hi folks, this is Tom O'Halloran from the Patriot Radio Show. If you're tired sitting on the sidelines and you want to get involved in turning this country around, if you want to actually have a hand in stopping the cancer of Islam that's spreading here in the homeland, do what I did. Look into becoming a Templar Knight. The Templars have been around for 1400 years, and they're known as Christ's warriors. Become a warrior for Christ and see what you can do to fight evil. We don't carry swords these days. My sword is my microphone. Yours might be a newsletter, a telephone, maybe a blog. I became a Templar Knight with the Military Order of Solomon's Temple. Why not go to MOOST.org and see what you can do to make a difference? Because if we don't, who will? Thank you.
Do I get stress headaches at work? Yes, definitely. From the moment I get in, it's, "Denise, we need this. Denise, we need that." Which is stressful, because my name is Linda. Denise is the other black woman that works here. By 10 a.m., someone in the copy room makes a joke about Kobe Bryant, and everyone looks at me to make sure it's okay. And I smile like it's okay. But really, My head and neck are starting to throb. Then I spend the rest of the afternoon training my interns and answering their questions like, yes, black people use shampoo, and no, I don't know any good reggae clubs around here, and yes, Condoleezza Rice is very articulate. Why do you sound so surprised? And no, I can't tell you where to buy weed. And that's when I reach for Excedrin. New Excedrin for racial tension headaches. Excedrin RT works fast, taking me from, oh no, you didn't, to I wish a mother would.
Excedrin for racial tension headaches. Fast relief for hundreds of years of nagging pain.
Yes, the time has come today. This is the Patriot Radio Show. I'm your host, Tom O'Halloran. Today, we are peeling the hero mask off Senator Yellowbelly McCain. We've been talking for the past 40 minutes about how he has been working diligently over the decades to hide the truth about the POWs left behind when the peace agreement was signed. He confessed and got better treatment than his fellow prisoners. His father and grandfather were rear admirals, so he got treated better. But to those that were left behind, he's turned his back. He let them die being tortured in prison rather than let the truth come out. There was a lot of evidence over the years that pointed to the facts that a lot of people were left behind, several hundred people. When Hanoi produced its list of 591 prisoners the day after the signing of the peace agreement, U.S. intelligence agencies expressed shock at the low number. Their number was hundreds higher. The New York Times published a long page-one story on February 2, 1973, about the discrepancy, especially raising questions about the number of prisoners held in Laos, only nine of whom were being returned. The headline ran in part, Laos POW list shows nine from U.S. Document disappointing to Washington as 311 were believed missing. According to the story by John Finney, other Washington officials believe the number of prisoners were substantially higher. There were two defense secretaries who served during the Vietnam War. They testified before the Senate POW Committee in September of 1992 that the prisoners were not returned. James Schlesinger and Melvin Laird, both speaking at a public session and under oath, said they based their conclusions on strong intelligence data, letters, eyewitness reports, even direct radio contacts. Under questioning, Schlesinger chose his words carefully, understanding clearly the volatility of the issue. I think that as of now, I can come to no other conclusion. Some were left behind. This ran counter to what President Nixon told the public in a nationally televised speech on March 29, 1973, when the repatriation of the 591 was in motion. Nixon said, "Tonight, the day we have worked and prayed for has finally come. For the first time in 12 years, no American military forces are in Vietnam. All our American POWs are on the way home." Documents unearthed since then show the aides had already briefed Nixon about the contrary evidence. Schlesinger was asked by the Senate committee for his explanation of why President Nixon would have made such a statement when he knew Hanoi was still holding prisoners. Schlesinger said, "One must assume that we had concluded
that the bargaining position of the United States was quite weak. We were anxious to get our troops out, and we were not going to roil the waters. What a bombshell of testimony. The New York Times appropriately reported it on page one, but again, there was no sustained follow-up by the Times or any other major newspaper or national news outlet. Over the years, the Defense Intelligence Agency received more than 1,600 first-hand sightings of live American prisoners and nearly 14,000 second-hand reports. Many witnesses interrogated by the Pentagon intelligence agents were deemed credible in the agents' reports. Some of the witnesses were given lie detector tests and passed. Sources involved with the author of this paper provided the author of this paper with copies of the witness reports, which are impressive in their detail. A lot of the sightings described a secondary tier of prison camps many miles from Hanoi, yet the DIA, after reviewing these reports, concluded that they do not constitute evidence that men were alive. In the late 70s and early 80s, listening stations picked up messages in which Laotian military personnel spoke about moving American prisoners from one labor camp to another. This is many years after the peace agreement has been signed, after all the men supposedly got turned over. These listening posts were manned by Thai communications officers trained by the NSA, which monitor signals worldwide. The NSA teams moved out after the fall of Saigon in 75 and passed the job on to Thai allies. But when the Thais turned these messages over to Washington, the intelligence community ruled that since the intercepts were made by a third party, namely Thailand, they could not be regarded as authentic. Now that's quite a catch-22. The U.S. trained a third party to take over the role as monitors of the signals about POWs. But because that third party did the monitoring, the messages weren't valid. What a crock of poop that is. We train our allies to do something that we're unable to do. When they do it and uncover evidence that our sons are still alive, it's determined invalid because they're third party. From the CIA files, here is an example that clearly exposes the farce. On December 27, 1980, a Thai military signal team picked up a message saying that prisoners were being moved out of Atopu, which is in southern Laos, by aircraft at 12:30 hours. 3 days later, a message was sent out from the CIA station in Bangkok to the CIA director's office in Langley. It read in part, "The prisoners are now in the valley in permanent location, a prison camp in central Laos. They were transferred from Atao to various places. POWs were kept in caves and are very thin, dark, and starving. Apparently, the prisoners are real." But the transmission was declared invalid by Washington because the information came from a third party and could not be deemed credible. This is insane. This is absolutely insane the way this information has been blocked and kept from the families. The very fact that these people might exist should have kept several teams working on finding where they are and extracting them. Instead, we turned our backs on the men. A series of what appeared to be distress signals from Vietnam and Laos were captured by the government satellite systems in the late 80s and early 90s. Before that period, no search for such signals had been put in place. Not a single one of these markings were ever deemed credible. Now, bear in mind, these are satellite photographs. Satellite photographs of markings they found on the ground. To the layman's eye, the satellite photos, some of which the author of this column had seen, show markings on the ground that are identical to the signals that the American pilots had been specifically trained to use in survival courses, such as certain letters like X or K drawn in a certain special way. Other markings were the secret four-digit authenticator numbers given to individual pilots. But time and again, the Pentagon, backed by the CIA, insisted that humans had not made the markings. What were they then? Shadows and vegetation, the government said, insisting that the markings were merely normal topographical contours, like sawgrass or rice paddy divider walls. It was an automatic response, shadows and vegetation. On one occasion, a Pentagon photo expert refused to go along. It was a missing man's name gouged into the field, he said, not trampled grass or paddy berms. His bosses responded by bringing in an outside contractor who found instead, yes, shadows and vegetation. This refrain led Bob Taylor, a highly regarded investigator on the Senate committee staff who had examined the photographic evidence, to comment, "If grass can spell out people's names and secret digit codes, then I have a newfound respect for grass." And on and on this goes. The facts, the evidence, the proof that we had men left behind. Hundreds of men, perhaps as many as 700, left in prison camps. That would be bad enough. But for a coward who confessed, a coward who got special treatment because his daddy was an admiral, for him to come back and parlay his so-called hero duties into a senatorial career, and to use that career to block the families of the POWs, to block the activists who are trying to get rescue missions, who are trying to find out where our sons and fathers were, who were trying to get them out while it was still feasible, while they were still alive. And McCain did everything he could possibly do to block this. He wrote bills and pushed them into law, keeping the secrets secret forever. He bullied and mocked anybody that tried to bring about the truth. John McCain, as Donald Trump said, John McCain is no hero. All John McCain did was get caught. He was a pilot. He flew some missions. So what? Then he got caught. Then he confessed. Then he came back and he stabbed the families and the prisoners of 700 some POWs, stabbed them in the back, ridiculed and mocked them, and did everything he could do legislatively to keep them from knowing where their sons were. That, my friends, is not a hero. That is a piece of shit. And I'm sorry, I don't very often use foul language on my radio show when I'm not speaking about the president. But John McCain is far from being a hero. How many of the 700 could have been brought home alive before they died of exposure, of hard labor, of starvation, of disease, of torture? Or were just plain executed when they had no more value
to the North Vietnamese. We turned our back on them long ago. And as a government, you can almost expect that. But as a former POW, it is a shameful, shameful thing. And I'm certainly hoping that somebody does a PSA if he ever tries to run for office again. Somebody does a campaign ad outing him for this behavior. Folks, that's the show for the today. Thanks for tuning in. Thanks for listening. Please spread the word about this coward, John McCain. Good day, America. God bless you and yours. This is Tom O'Halloran. I'm out.
The leader in talk radio on the internet, right here on K98Talk.com.
When our water heater broke down last month, it was a nightmare. It took 5 hours for the plumber to show up, and he charged us a couple of $100 just to come out. Then it cost another $1,800 to put in the new water heater. By the time it was all said and done, I felt like I'd been taken. But what else could I do?
The smartest thing you can do is get a home warranty from American Residential Warranty. Their home warranties pay to repair or replace all your major appliances when they break. And they will break, and at the worst possible time. Call American Residential Warranty right now for free information on home warranties starting at just pennies a day. Don't wait for your refrigerator to stop running or your ceiling fans to stop turning. Call American Residential Warranty right now. Ask how you can save up to 50% on washer and dryer coverage. Just call 1-800-513-6154. That's 1-800-513-6154. Again, 1-800-513-6154. Call now.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 1-800-516-7602 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 1-800-516-7602 to take your call right now. Call 1-800-516-7602. That's 1-800-516-7602. Again, 1-800-516-7602.